This is a star-studded cast for the canoe single C1 men. In the current world rankings, we have 6 of the top 10, and Michael Martichel not even in the top 10. So it's a really, really strong competition and a really, really pedigree field. As you can see, it's an all-European final, 3 from Slovakia, 3 from Slovenia. And we have Italy, Germany, Poland, and Great Britain. Matej Benesch, he has a wonderful style, very, very at ease on this big water from Slovakia. Missed out on the top 3, so probably won't be going to the Worlds, but let's see how he negotiates the first big drop.
Perfectly. Oh, nothing worse than having the worry of getting down that top drop well and then touching the upstream.
Well, it's exactly the same course for the men as for the women. Let's see the contrasting different styles, how they keep their energy going.
What you'll notice right away is that the only athlete likely to do any switching from one side to the other will be Stefano Cipressi, who was a world champion actually in the kayak class and then suffered an injury that forced him to switch to C1. The rest of these athletes will stay on their on side and use the offside stroke without changing their hands. Despite that mistake at gate 2 with the touch, he's actually having quite a nice run, keeping the boat moving, good power on the blade, not wasting time anywhere.
So far, only 2 faults, but most of the men in the semi-final managed to go down the whole course without fault. Can't say the same for the K1, but the C1 men seem to safely master this.
Oh, and he's missed the wave. Does well, actually, though, to use the slack water behind the wave to press the boat across, having to use some of that energy that he was able to save by staying online the rest of the course.
Well, it's a competitive first round. 110 seconds, but the action says it all.
You can't help but wonder if that early 2-second penalty kind of lit a fire under him, but he wasn't able to kind of keep his emotions in check. It's easy here to put in a lot of effort, but actually not be going anywhere. If you're not on the flow and using the power in the water here, it can really make you pay with a lot of time ticking away.
Next to go, Michael Martichel. In 1998, when they had the World Cup here, he ended up taking the gold medal. So that was 16 years ago. And had been taking gold medals 3 years before that. So a bit of a phenomenon. Didn't look like, watching the semi-finals, when he was halfway down the run, it looked like he was going to be out, but really put forward a good last few gates and really took a bit of a challenges in this second one.
Yeah, another instance where he had a good run down the drop, but then ended up not controlling his bow well enough and taking a touch on the upstream. This is an athlete, though, who often paddles very much within himself, and when something goes wrong, he's got a couple of extra gears that he can dive into to try and really pull down the course quickly.
11:12 this morning, I was speaking to a couple of athletes who've been down there saying the water levels are changing a lot, so it's very difficult to keep the line. And here coming into 14, need to keep the speed so you can go around the left side of the rock.
He took a lot of risk on that offset and it paid off.
Well, 1.3,
straight line.
Sorry, 1.83 seconds so far up. Needs to keep the momentum going.
Yeah, this last cross is going to be critical if he has any hopes of having a podium with that penalty on the board. As you said, very few athletes took penalties in the C1 semifinal. Excellent cross, wasted very little time, kept the boat running very quickly.
Reference point is 110. It's going to be very close. Well, at the end of the day, not all that close. 4 seconds up. Last week, he took the bronze medal, and he said it was a terrible run. So let's see how he comes with his own high standards.
Yeah, without that penalty, it would have been the fastest time of the day so far of the C1 men. The one good thing, even with that penalty, is he's put a time on the board that was very competitive from this morning, and that puts pressure on everyone else that has to follow him.
Just a quick warning now, we have Anze Berdjic, fan club, just in front of us, and Anze Berdjic, in the heats, he was 3 seconds ahead of everyone else, and he scared them a little bit. They actually went quiet at the end of the semi-finals, but he has qualified and expects some noise from the local man.
I would say there are very few venues that are as loud as Totsen when a Slovenian is on the course.
And why not? He must be able to hear them when he's coming down. We can't see anything out of the window now. Everyone's standing up in front of us. We have to stand up ourselves.
A little bit low and picks up a penalty on the downstream before the upstream. Was one of those penalties, though, he may not know he's taken it, which means he may not have the opportunity to put that extra gear in force to try and get down the course a little bit quicker, knowing he's made a mistake.
Well, as we saw the first slip, he was in touch, but 1 second down.
Nicely executed in that offset sequence, not letting his boat slow down too much or waste too much time shifting from side to side.
See where he's at the split. He's going to have to really push it. It's 1.7 down at the split. Coming under us now, coming under the bridge. If applause can help, he's going to win it by a mile.
Michael Martikan executed this last section very well, so to already be 1.7 down is going to be difficult.
There we come. This is the crucial.
He caught the wave, but he didn't run the boat across the way Martikan did. He had a little hiccup halfway across. I think any chance he had of catching him ended there.
Well, 106.06 is not going to happen. Moves into provisional second place. Polite applause from his family and friends. So far, as we mentioned, it's coming down the semi-final run, which is identical to this one. It was fairly fast and no penalties. Will it be the extra stress of just trying to push it?
I think part of it is knowing he did a 108 in the semi-final and 105 won it, and he needs to find those 3 seconds somewhere if he has a chance of being on the podium. And you can't discount, too, being a home crowd, that home pressure of delivering a medal for these people. Be tough sometimes.
Here we go. Familiar style of David Florence, double world champion, won last weekend in London. It's the first time I can remember that his parents aren't running down the course with him, so let's see how he goes alone.
Probably one of the fittest athletes on the circuit.
Last year he was, I think, one of the only Brits who actually decided to go in, or was able to go in, all World Cups. Struggled a bit there, but obviously came to form in the last World Championships.
That's where it counts. Double world champion. Not many people can say that. Got held up a little bit on the entry into that upstream, didn't penetrate enough to keep the boat running, and then trying to get his speed back, he ends up taking the penalty with his top hand. You never want to take a penalty, but when you take a penalty and you're also losing time, that's just adding insult to injury, unfortunately.
Well, he's one of the fastest on the circuit, but he's going to have to be, because he's 7 seconds down. It's a big ask.
I'm not sure there's enough course left to make up 7 seconds, unfortunately, even if he's perfect from here down.
Well, he's made up 2 seconds, 5 seconds to make up.
Ran the boat nicely there. He didn't let the hydraulic whitewater stop his boat much. Much better than some of the other athletes we've seen come through there.
Well, he shouldn't be tired, because he actually went in the first round of the heats, decided not to go in the second round. Let's see how he goes across here.
No, not able to catch the wave, fighting for it, but not able to catch it, which means it's his own power that gets him across, and it's not going to be as fast as using the surf from the wave.
Well, You can't win them all. He wins most of them. .766 seconds off, and he's going to be in the commentary booth tomorrow, so we'll actually find out what his own thoughts were then.
That was just one of those runs that at this point in this upstream got a little bit sideways and wasn't able to get the boat running again in a way that kind of made any difference to his running time. It was just a looked like a lot of effort, but not effort that was creating speed.
Well, we're perhaps not going to have quite the same volumes as noise as we had for Anzi Berchek, but we're going to be pretty loud for this next competitor. Benzi Szolczek is known as one of the fastest and possibly not the most consistent competitor, but really can put a run together when he's in form.
Yeah, Benny can really move the boat. Another one who has a good run down the drop and then touches gate two. Make matters worse, he actually ended up dropping his stern too far and touched the bottom of the course, stopping the rotation of his bow, which means his exit was not as fast as it could have been.
But he's he's flying, isn't he? Absolutely keeping the boat pointing in the right direction. And 1 second up the split.
Could this be one of those local knowledge runs that just uses the white water to magical effect? Doesn't look like the prettiest run, but to be 1 second up, doing something right up there.
Well, that's what we saw last year in the last couple of years in the World Cup Series. He's leading in the heats, didn't quite manage to put it together. Well, it's going to be really close. He's the same as Marty Campbell, one of a second down. But as you mentioned, Marty can really manage to put forward a good last three or four gates.
Really fast on that offset under the bridge, barely changed his line at all. This is where it's all going to be critical, though. He should know how to catch this wave in his sleep, having done it who knows how many times, and he does. This finishing sprint's going to be very interesting.
1:06.06 to go for. It's going to be really close.
Really close.
On the line. Well, again, not that close.
Wow.
Delighted Malton Markican in the little picture. Let's see his facial features. Is he happy?
I would say you'd have to be anytime Mardikan's sitting on the top step and you bump him off. Especially at home. But I think he had to dive into that tickle trunk to find a little local knowledge there. Not the prettiest run, but found those little currents we talked about that shift to make sure that he was always pulling in a direction that got him to the finish line faster than Mardikan.
Interesting from the locals below, the Anze Berchitz fan club, because they were cheering, but he's dropped Berchitz into third place. So it's a bit of a mixed emotion there. Stefano Cipressi, as you mentioned before, he's been a world champion in the K1s, now moved across the C1s and switching all the time.
Yeah, I'm amazed that in the men's event you'll see someone switching, but he does it very well. It's that experience he has as a kayak to be able to paddle well on both sides. Always making sure he's got that power stroke exactly where he needs it. You'll watch the other canoes having to reach across to use what we call a crossbow stroke. Not always the same strength. 2 seconds in advantage, but remember, he's clean at this point where those other athletes had a penalty.
Last week, he missed out just on the final coming 12th in Lee Valley. 31 years old, massive experience. Let's see how he puts it together.
Switching in the middle of a very technical offset sequence and keeping the boat running very nicely. It'll be interesting to see this next split. I haven't seen him throw away any time here.
Wait, still a second up. The crowd below, silent watching.
Choosing to spin and maybe picking up a penalty. I see the judges making some form of indication.
But a 2 second penalty. Szolczek actually spun on his semi-final as well.
Yeah, but those athletes that were able to go direct and keep that bow pointing downstream are really going to make a lot of time there.
Well, after an amazing start, it's going to be really close. Time to go for his 1:04. He's not going to do that, but can he take a medal? Well, provisionally moves into third place, but thinks he could have done better.
knows that penalty is going to hurt when the final results are posted. I think he also knows he wasn't maybe quite as crisp at the last part of the course as he could have been. The midway section, he had really put quite a tidy run together.
No one clear. All 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 paddlers so far have had a 2-second penalty.
Opens the door for our last four competitors for sure.
Next competitor, 31-year-old Alexander Slavskovsky. Not an Olympian, but makes stacks and stacks of finals.
It's pretty tough when you have to make a team with the guy making the team winning the Olympics more often than not. One of those athletes who probably would have his own drawer full of Olympic medals had he not had to go against Mardikin to make the team.
See where the first split, and he's in touch, more than in touch. He's nearly a second up so far. Very tall with a long reach.
Long reach and a very efficient paddler. When he's on a good run, his strokes count for a lot. Doesn't waste much.
Well, we saw in Augsburg last season, 2013, in the World Cup, he won by a country mile. Here he goes, has a 2-second penalty.
I'm not sure I saw that. I saw him splash one of the gates, which made it move. So hopefully the video judge is able to assess that, whether in fact he did touch it or not.
Well, accordingly to that, there is a chance to come off. We saw Fabian Dorfler, who was had a penalty, come off in the K1s. We're going to see him soon in the final. So there is potential there. He's under the bridge.
His last move, as we've said already, is critical. Oh, such poise, beautiful. Waits till the exact right moment to put in the power and ends up surfing across very quickly using very little of his own energy.
Unfortunately, left a little bit too much earlier on. Benji Sosek is in a good position. That puts him way down, only 4.5 seconds off, but way down in the rankings. Three to go. Sosek looking good for a medal. No one's really mastered all aspects of the course so far, have they?
No, and that's the complexity of the changeability of the whitewater, showing there where he may have taken his touch in the slow motion just off the front of his buoyancy aid.
Even, by the way, if there is an appeal, which I can't see on the screen, and it comes off, it would still put him way down the field.
Not fast enough.
Sidiris Tasiadis, very short paddle, knows how to use it there. They're taking about 19 strokes to get over the edge. He dropped slightly low.
I think he was more wide than low, which means he wasn't using any speed anywhere. He was just kind of floundering for a second. They'll be curious to see what his midway split as he takes a penalty, which won't help it.
Well, not sure if that penalty is included, but it's a little bit off the pace in early doors.
When he's on, you can tell there's a confidence to his paddling and his strokes. He's sort of right on and under the poles in the upstreams, and he's just giving everything a little bit more width than I think will be fast enough, dropping his paddle there. Something's got him, I think, a little bit unsettled in this run and just not the level of confidence necessary to reach the podium.
World Cup last weekend came eighth. As we all know, he does have the Olympic silver medal from 2012. Estange clearly took the gold medal. It's not going right for him today. Completely penalty after penalty, unfortunately.
This is one of those runs on Totsen where it just starts ugly and ends ugly.
Benjamin Sosek has a medal for Slovenia.
Does well there, though, to catch the wave. Surfing in right under the pole. Taking another penalty there on the sprint to the finish.
Soseki in your picture in the small square, looking very, very delighted, but certainly hasn't won it yet. We have another Slovenian to go. Two more competitors to go from Tatson. Weather's holding off well, which is great news.
Our next competitor was a bit of a surprise for me to be in the top three.
Ranked officially number 36 in the world, that's from Poland, Gregor Hedwig, 25 years old. Last week in Lee Valley came 16th, so I suppose he's the, like you say, he's the one of the few who's not yet a world champion.
Interesting to see if he can recreate the sort of confidence he had on that first run, because it was sort of every stroke counted exactly how he needed it. And right off the bat, he's finding himself crabbing the boat where it's sideways rather than running with the stern following the bow.
Well, last year, Tatson was kind to him. He came sixth, and the other two events he went into with Cardiff and Augsburg, he came 23rd and 27th. So he's good to be in a final, but it's fallen apart already.
Yeah, I think the situation has gotten the better of him, being one of the last couple to start, knowing that he has the skill to get on the podium. Sometimes here, waiting a split second for the right stroke is better than any stroke. And it just seems like he's rushing things and it's not paying off for him.
But as we said, amazing in 36 in the world to actually make the final. Barring something extraordinary, which won't happen, it means that Mikhail Martikainen also has a medal. Savchek guaranteed at least the silver. But to be saying that, he's putting forward a good end of the run.
It's actually rare on Tatson to be so unsettled to start and finish well. So credit to this athlete to be able to put it back together. Does well to catch the wave, surfs it across. How quickly can he get out and get on his finish sprint?
Silver medal would be 106.06.
Not going to get there.
Well, Soshek, in your picture, is guaranteed a medal. It's always a bit dangerous for the spectators when there's a Polish paddler going down, because we have the Polacek family running down. Four brothers, two sisters.
Great paddling family.
Matthias, by the way, is going to be commentating tomorrow, so we'll hear about the family and how they managed to put such an amazing team together. Well, the reason that the crowd and the announcers at stateside are quite enthusiastic is we do have a Slovenian gold medalist. We don't know who yet, but we have a gold medalist, because the last to go is Luka Božić, who won the C2 last weekend. 23 years old. C1 last weekend was 24, so he has something to go for. The show's local knowledge is quite a lot here.
It is, but he's really been coming on. He ventured out of the C2 last year. Not sure why, if his partner was injured or what, but he started racing more C1 and really started to show that he has the skill to go it alone. Early penalty, though. Will he be able to use local knowledge to make up that 2 seconds? At least get on the podium.
Good, the Berzic family is in fine voice again. Now they've realized that Anze's out the medals.
Doing well, keeping the boat moving. Next split will be interesting.
As we see, 4 seconds of penalties. He's going to really do something special, have to do something special to come through. Yes, he's in touch. That's extraordinary. 1.5 seconds down with 4 seconds of penalties.
Shows his time is fast. It's just that inability to stay off the poles is killing him right now.
Well, as you mentioned, the crucial stage. See how he surfs across the wave when he comes down over here.
Oh! He saw him get pushed just a little funny before the drop, and he wasn't able to get his boat back online as he came down. Did well to catch the wave, but actually overdid it, almost piling his bow into the wave.
Well, that was very, very costly. If it wasn't for the 4 seconds, but you can always say if it wasn't.
even just that last surf probably would have put him on the podium had he been able to nail that.
Well, let's hope. Tomorrow, we'll obviously have the semi-finals of the C2s. Let's hope the local crowd and ourselves have the joy of watching them again tomorrow. If you just tuned in, Jess Fox won the first event by 15 seconds. She won the C1 with a great run there. Katerina Hoskova was second, and Zheng Cheng Tang, the second week in a row, took bronze medal for China. The event you've just seen now is the C1 men's. And here we go, the official results. Benjamin Sajcek for Slovenia takes the gold. Mikhail Martikan for Slovakia takes the silver. And Stefano Cipressi for Italy takes the bronze, with Luka Bozic for the locals and Andy Berzic taking fourth and fifth. As David, you say something about the penalties there.
Yeah, very interesting to see a final where no clean runs were put on the board. Shows you the complexity of the whitewater here and how difficult the course set has been. The qualification course was very difficult. This one a little bit more with the flow, but still, it's a tough weekend for the athletes.
Well, we're going from one event in the semi-finals where there was no penalties, well, very few penalties, and we're going to move on into the kayak men's singles where there were stacks and stacks of penalties, weren't there? The Momelti was out with the 50. We had Joe Clark for England, Great Britain out full of 50, Priskovic out full of 50, Mike Kerr for Switzerland out for 50. And they went on and on and on. They were all missing gate 2 and gate 5, weren't they?
Yeah, it's that fine line between making sure you have a fast line but still negotiating the upstreams where you actually put your whole head inside the gate.